There are two powers that alone can effect in their conjunction the great and difficult thing which is the aim of our endeavor, a fixed and unfailing aspiration that calls from below, and a supreme grace from above that answers. But the supreme grace will act only in the conditions of the light and the truth. It will not act in conditions led upon it by the falsehood and the ignorance. For if it were to yield to the demands of the falsehood, it would defeat its own purpose. These are the conditions of the light and truth, the sole conditions under which the highest force will descend. And it is only the very highest supramental force descending from above and opening from below that can victoriously handle the physical nature and annihilate its difficulties. There must be a total and sincere surrender. There must be an exclusive self-opening to the divine power. There must be a constant and integral choice of the truth that is descending, a constant and integral rejection of the falsehood of the mental, vital, and physical powers and appearances that still rule the earth nature. The surrender must be total and seize all the parts of the being. It is not enough that the psychic should respond and the higher mental accept, or even the inner vital submit, and the inner physical consciousness feel the influence. There must be in no part of the being, even the most external, anything that makes a reserve, anything that hides behind doubts, confusion, and subterfuges, anything that revolts or refuses. If part of the being surrenders, but another part reserves itself, follows its own way, or makes its own conditions, then each time that happens, you are yourself pushing the divine grace away from you. If behind your devotion and surrender you make a cover for your desires, egoistic demands, and vital insistences, if you put these things in place of the true aspiration, or mix them with it, and try to impose them on the divine Shakti, then it is idle to invoke the divine grace to transform you. If you open yourself on one side or in one part to the truth, and on another side are constantly opening the gates to hostile forces, it is vain to expect that the divine grace will abide with you. You must keep the temple clean if you wish to install there the living presence. If each time the power intervenes and brings in the truth, you turn your back on it and call in again the falsehood that has been expelled, it is not the divine grace that you must blame for failing you, but the falsity of your own will and the imperfection of your own surrender. If you call for the truth, and yet something in you chooses what is false, ignorant and undivine, or even simply is unwilling to reject it altogether, then always you will be open to attack, and the grace will recede from you. Detect first what is false or obscure in you, and persistently reject it. Then alone can you rightly call for the divine power to transform you. Do not imagine that truth and falsehood, light and darkness, surrender and selfishness can be allowed to dwell together in the house consecrated to the divine. The transformation must be integral, and integral therefore the rejection of all that withstands it. Reject the false notion that the divine power will do and is bound to do everything for you at your demand. And even though you do not satisfy the conditions laid down by the Supreme, make your surrender true and complete, then only will all else be done for you. Reject, too, the false and indolent expectation that the divine power will do even the surrender for you. The Supreme demands your surrender to her, but does not impose it. You are free at every moment till the irrevocable transformation comes to deny and to reject the divine, or to recall your self-giving if you are willing to suffer the spiritual consequence. Your surrender must be self-made and free. It must be the surrender of a living being, not of an inert automaton or mechanical tool. An inert passivity is constantly confused with the real surrender. But out of an inner passivity, nothing true and powerful can come. It is the inert passivity of physical nature that leaves it at the mercy of every obscure or undivine influence. A glad and strong and helpful submission is demanded to the working of the divine force. The obedience of the illumined disciple of the truth, of the inner warrior who fights against obscurity and falsehood, of the faithful servant of the divine. This is the true attitude, and only those who can take and keep it preserve a faith unshaken by disappointments and difficulties, and shall pass through the ordeal to the supreme victory and the great transmutation. In all that is done in the universe, the divine, through his Shakti, is behind all action, but he is veiled by his yoga maya and works through the ego of the jiva in the lower nature. In yoga also, It is the divine who is the sadaka and the sadhana. It is his shakti with her light, power, knowledge, consciousness, ananda, acting upon the adhara. And when it is open to her, pouring into it with these divine forces that make the sadhana possible. But so long as the lower nature is active, the personal effort of the sadhaka remains necessary. The personal effort required is a triple labor of aspiration, rejection, and surrender. An aspiration, vigilant, constant, unceasing. The mind's will, the heart's seeking, the ascent of the vital being, the will to open and make plastic the physical consciousness and nature. Rejection of the movements of the lower nature. Rejection of the mind's ideas, opinions, preferences, habits, constructions, so that the true knowledge may find free room in a silent mind. Rejection of the vital nature's desires, demands, cravings, sensations, passions, selfishness, pride, arrogance, lust, greed, jealousy, envy, hostility to the truth, so that the true power and joy may pour from above into a calm, large, strong, and consecrated vital being. Rejection of the physical nature's stupidity, doubt, disbelief, obscurity, obstinacy, pettiness, laziness, unwillingness to change, tamas, so that the true stability of light, power, ananda may establish itself in a body growing always more divine. Surrender of oneself, and all one is and has, and every plane of the consciousness and every movement to the divine and the Shakti. In proportion as the surrender and self-consecration progress, the sadhaka becomes conscious of the divine Shakti doing the sadhana, pouring into him more and more of herself, founding in him the freedom and perfection of the divine nature. The more this conscious process replaces his own effort, the more rapid and true becomes his progress. But it cannot completely replace the necessity of personal effort until the surrender and consecration are pure and complete from top to bottom. Note that a tamasic surrender, refusing to fulfill the conditions and calling on God to do everything and save one all the trouble and struggle, is a deception and does not lead to freedom and perfection. To walk through life armored against all fear, peril, and disaster, only two things are needed, two that go always together. The grace of the Divine Mother and, on your side, an inner state made up of faith, sincerity, and surrender. Let your faith be pure, candid, and perfect. An egoistic faith in the mental and vital being, tainted by ambition, pride, vanity, mental arrogance, vital self-will, personal demand, desire for the petty satisfactions of the lower nature, is a low and smoke-obscured flame that cannot burn upwards to heaven. Regard your life has given you only for the divine work and to help in the divine manifestation. Desire nothing but the purity, force, light, wideness, calm, and wonder of the divine consciousness and its insistence to transform and perfect your mind, life, and body. Ask for nothing but the divine, spiritual, and supramental truth. Its realization on earth and in you and in all who are called and chosen, and the conditions needed for its creation and its victory over all opposing forces. Let your sincerity and surrender be genuine and entire. When you give yourself, give completely, without demand, without condition, without reservation, so that all in you shall belong to the Divine Mother and nothing be left to the ego or given to any other power. The more complete your faith, sincerity, and surrender, the more will grace and protection be with you. And when the grace and protection of the Divine Mother are with you, what is there that can touch you, or whom need you fear? A little of it even will carry you through all difficulties obstacles and dangers. Surrounded by its full presence, you can go securely on your way, because it is hers, careless of all menace, unaffected by any hostility, however powerful, whether from this world or from worlds invisible. Its touch can turn difficulties into opportunities, failure into success, and weakness into unfaltering strength. For the grace of the Divine Mother is the sanction of the Supreme, and now or tomorrow its effect is sure, a thing decreed, inevitable and irresistible. Money is the visible sign of a universal force, and this force, in its manifestation on Earth, works on the vital and physical planes and is indispensable to the fullness of the outer life. In its origin and its true action, it belongs to the divine. But, like other powers of the divine, it is delegated here. And in the ignorance of the lower nature, can be usurped for the uses of the ego, or held by Asuric influences and perverted to their purpose. This is indeed one of the three forces: power, wealth, sex, that have the strongest attraction for the human ego and the Asura, and are most generally misheld and misused by those who retain them. The seekers or keepers of wealth are more often possessed rather than its possessors. Few escape entirely a certain distorting influence stamped on it by its long seizure and perversion by the Asura. For this reason, most spiritual disciplines insist on a complete self-control, detachment, and renunciation of all bondage to wealth and of all personal and egoistic desire for its possession. Some even put a ban on money and riches and proclaim poverty and bareness of life as the only spiritual condition. But this is an error. It leaves the power in the hands of the hostile forces. To reconquer it for the divine to whom it belongs and use it divinely for the divine life is the supramental way for the sadaka. You must neither turn with an ascetic shrinking from the money power, the means it gives, and the objects it brings, nor cherish a rajasic attachment to them or a spirit of enslaving self-indulgence in their gratifications. Regard wealth simply as a power to be won back for the mother and placed at her service. All wealth belongs to the divine, and those who hold it are trustees, not possessors. It is with them today, tomorrow it may be elsewhere. All depends on the way they discharge their trust, while it is with them, in what spirit, with what consciousness, in their use of it, to what purpose. In your personal use of money, look on all you have, or get, or bring, as the mother's. Make no demand, but accept what you receive from her, and use it for the purposes for which it is given to you. Be entirely selfless, entirely scrupulous, exact, careful in detail, a good trustee. Always consider that it is her possessions and not your own that you are handling. On the other hand, what you receive for her, lay religiously before her. Turn nothing to your own or anybody else's purpose. Do not look up to men because of their riches, or allow yourself to be impressed by the show, the power, or the influence. When you ask for the mother, you must feel that it is she who is demanding through you a very little of what belongs to her. And the man from whom you ask will be judged by his response. If you are free from the money taint, but without any ascetic withdrawal, you will have a greater power to command the money for the divine work. Equality of mind, absence of demand, and the full dedication of all you possess and receive, and all your power of acquisition to the divine Shakti, and her work are the signs of this freedom. Any perturbation of mind with regard to money and its use, any claim, any grudging, is a sure index of some imperfection or bondage. The ideal sadaka in this kind is one who, if required to live poorly, can so live, and no sense of want will affect him or interfere with the full inner play of the divine consciousness. And if he is required to live richly, can so live, and never for a moment fall into desire or attachment to his wealth or to the things that he uses, or servitude to self-indulgence, or a weak bondage to the habits that the possession of riches creates. The divine will is all for him, and the divine Ananda. In the supramental creation, the money force has to be restored to the divine power and used for a true and beautiful and harmonious equipment and ordering of a new divinized vital and physical existence in whatever way the Divine Mother herself decides in her creative vision. But first, it must be conquered back for her, and those will be strongest for the conquest who are in this part of their nature strong and large and free from ego and surrendered without any claim or withholding or hesitation, pure and powerful channels for the supreme puissance. If you want to be a true doer of divine works, your first aim must be to be totally free from all desire and self-regarding ego. All your life must be an offering and a sacrifice to the Supreme. Your only object in action shall be to serve, to receive, to fulfill, to become a manifesting instrument of the Divine Shakti in her work. You must grow in the divine consciousness till there is no difference between your will and hers. No motive except her impulsion in you. No action that is not her conscious action in you and through you, until you are capable of this complete dynamic identification. You have to regard yourself as a soul and body created for her service, one who does all for her sake. Even if the idea of the separate worker is strong in you, and you feel that it is you who do the act, yet it must be done for her. All stress of egoistic choice, all hankering after personal profit, all stipulation of self-regarding desire must be extirpated from the nature. There must be no demand for fruit and no seeking for reward. The only fruit for you is the pleasure of the Divine Mother and the fulfillment of her work. Your only reward, a constant progression in divine consciousness and calm and strength and bliss. The joy of service and the joy of inner growth through work is the sufficient recompense of the selfless worker. But a time will come when you feel more and more that you are the instrument and not the worker. For first, by the force of your devotion, your contact with the Divine Mother will become so intimate that at all times you will have only to concentrate and to put everything into her hands, to have her present guidance, her direct command or impulse, the sure indication of the thing to be done and the way to do it and the result. And afterwards you will realize that the Divine Shakti not only inspires and guides but initiates and carries out your works. All your movements are originated by her. All your powers are hers. Mind, life, and body are conscious and joyful instruments of her action, means for her play, molds for her manifestation in the physical universe. There can be no more happy condition than this union and dependence. For this step carries you back beyond the borderline from the life of stress and suffering in the ignorance into the truth of your spiritual being, into its deep peace and its intense ananda. While this transformation is being done, it is more than ever necessary to keep yourself free from all taint of the perversions of the ego. Let no demand or insistence creep in to stain the purity of the self-giving and the sacrifice. There must be no attachment to the work or the result, no laying down of conditions, no claim to possess the power that should possess you, no pride of the instrument, no vanity or arrogance, nothing in the mind or in the vital or physical parts should be suffered to distort to its own use or cease for its own personal and separate satisfaction the greatness of the forces that are acting through you. Let your faith, your sincerity, your purity of aspiration be absolute and pervasive of all the planes and layers of the being. Then every disturbing element and distorting influence will progressively fall away from your nature. The last stage of this perfection will come when you are completely identified with the Divine Mother and feel yourself to be no longer another and separate being, instrument, servant, or worker, but truly a child and eternal portion of her consciousness and force. Always she will be in you and you in her. It will be your constant, simple, and natural experience that all your thought and seeing and action, your very breathing or moving, come from her and are hers. You will know and see and feel that you are a person and power formed by her, out of herself, put out from her for the play, and yet always safe in her, being of her being, consciousness of her consciousness, force of her force, Ananda of her Ananda. When this condition is entire, and her supramental energies can freely move you, then you will be perfect in divine works. Knowledge, will, action will become sure, simple, luminous, spontaneous, flawless, an outflow from the Supreme, a divine movement of the Eternal.